One of the most frequent questions I get in the comments in regards to SETI are viewers wondering, rightly, how exactly do astronomers know that advanced aliens would still be using radio waves in their communications? This is a fair point. We don't actually know that. Aliens may be using one of several different types of largely hypothetical interstellar communication that we've only recently thought of, and maybe new methods lie within the parts of physics that we do not understand. Without at least a solid theory of quantum gravity, or more, we may live in a universe where we really do not know what possibilities might lie in things like dark matter and dark energy, using other dimensions for communication, and communicating through wormholes, and so on. But the simple answer to the question about Radio SETI is that at the time when Radio SETI began, the days of Kokoni and Morrison and Frank Drake's Project Ozma, radio was the only thing we knew how to look for. Might as well do what you already know and see if anyone is on the dial, so to speak. But things like shortwave radio show us there were once many voices. But once you scan the shortwave bands these days, you won't find anywhere near as many signals. Things go obsolete and fall out of use. Well, maybe that's how interstellar communications work, and that radio is just a stepping stone that you later, at least, partly, abandon. The rebuttal argument here is rather fundamental. Radio may be cheap and easy for everyone, and everyone does it to some degree for the entirety of their technological existence. Radar, for example, is not really an invention, per se, though its equipment is. But the electromagnetic waves it uses are a property of nature. Properties of nature tend not to go obsolete, especially if they remain the best method of radar mapping and monitoring the asteroids of your solar system. When we did that with Arecibo's now lost massive transmitter, it turns out that mapping missions' signals rank among the most powerful signals humans have ever sent out into space, and would be visible at a distance. Likewise, aliens using radar for the same purpose would also be visible at a distance. So all is not lost for Radio SETI. There remains centuries of work left there. Only problem is, we stopped transmitting anything when Arecibo collapsed, and no other radio telescope can transmit a comparably powerful signal. Radio signals, by and large, listen. They do not speak. Yet Arecibo did. But our technology has progressed, and a new possibility for SETI is coming on the table. This is gravitational wave SETI, using gravity itself for communication. To explore that, we need to look at gravitational waves. They were first predicted in 1893 by Oliver Heaviside, and also a bit later by Henri Poincaré in 1905, specifically as a counterpart in gravity to electromagnetic waves. In 1916, Albert Einstein showed that his general theory of relativity describes gravitational waves as ripples in space-time, propagating across the universe. This is in fact how they behave, and hints of gravitational waves started to appear in the 1970s. Indirect evidence for their existence first surfaced in 1974, resulting from the orbital decay of a binary pulsar system, which matched in a roundabout way the predictions of general relativity. Energy loss to gravitational wave emission causes a predictable decay, leading to an eventual Nobel Prize to Hulse and Taylor for their discovery. This is known as the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. In 2015 was the famous direct observation by LIGO confirming the existence of gravitational waves emanating from the merger of two black holes, which resulted in the awarding of more Nobel Prizes. Gravitational waves really are a lot like electromagnetic waves, such as visible light and radio. They are just radiant energy that results from gravitational action. Here, Newton's laws have proven incomplete and an error on an assumption. Newton assumed that gravity propagates instantly, and thus his model of gravitation does not predict gravitational waves. It turns out that gravity propagates at the speed of light, not instantly. This actually leads into a sort of spooky thought if you think about it. So we know that the speed of light is 186,000 miles per second. You can actually measure that. It's a constant in a vacuum and it's been done many times. It's not merely something Einstein came up with. Rather, he built upon other work like Maxwell by establishing it as a constant. but gravity for some reason also propagates at exactly this speed. Yet it turns out that so does time. Time famously dilates with acceleration, and again this has been measured, until when you reach the speed of light, it simply stops, leading to the famous idea that photons do not experience the passage of time. Moreover, it also happens to be the point at which the energy you need to accelerate to get to the speed of light goes to infinity. That's an awful lot of convergence of phenomena that may not necessarily appear to be related, but somehow they are, and it happens all at that one point. All one can really say is that these convergences simply represent the maximum speed of information in the universe, which is an odd statement in and of itself, but it's what is used. But the detection of gravitational waves, unequivocally, has represented an onset of a whole new way to study the universe that we can now technologically do. This could get extremely interesting as it develops. We can only right now barely do this stuff with LIGO and others, and not at that great of resolution. It is the beginning, but it has to be remembered that most of the matter in the universe is dark matter. It does not interact electromagnetically, but it does interact gravitationally, meaning that studying gravitational waves could yield clues about the nature of dark matter and dark energy. Part of the issue is that we have not yet begun looking at gravitational waves at very many frequency ranges. The coming LISA detector will expand on this, into millihertz and microhertz ranges. Oddly, this will allow the search for trying to detect gravitational effects of otherwise dark near-Earth objects, such as primordial black holes, if they exist, at least potentially, but back to searching for alien civilizations through gravitational waves. It turns out gravitational waves have an advantage that electromagnetic waves do not have. In short, you can't block gravity. Electromagnetism, you can. In fact, we actually rely on it being blocked, at least visual light, for certain parts of astronomy, and even artificially block it with telescope masks to reduce glare. We also do this with hats and brims, umbrellas on the beach, and so on. It's easy. The fact that the dust and gas of the Milky Way obscures tons of it from us, and what's behind that, is the heart of the mystery of the Great Attractor. We can't see through the galaxy easily to observe it. We just know that it's gravitationally pulling galaxies towards it. Perhaps it's a supercluster of galaxies. But the confounding factor for that mystery is a lack of transparency of the Milky Way. And it works that way with radio and the rest of the electromagnetic spectrum. Areas of it get blocked by certain things. And in one area, the Earth's atmosphere is enough to block some frequencies of light. This does not happen with gravitational waves, and that might be attractive for aliens that can engage in it for communication. If you can do it, which is complicated, I'll get to that in a moment, then nothing can stop or interfere with your messaging. There is also another advantage. While gravity can be loud, as you may term it, areas of the gravitational spectrum work somewhat like radio noise. There are areas where the universe is loud from natural sources, and areas where it's quiet, which might be good frequency areas for communications. Our instrumentation is generally currently tuned to the loudest sources, pairs of black holes. We aren't really equipped with sensitive enough instruments for searching for alien gravity communications quite yet. But even then, even for advanced aliens, it will be difficult to create gravitational waves detectable at long distances, even with a lot of sensitivity. You need to move mass around at high speed no matter what you do. As it stands, it's exceedingly difficult to detect the gravitational wave interactions of the nearest star system, in this case Alpha Centauri A and B. Proxima is hopelessly low mass. This would seem like a tall order, an alien civilization communicating with members of itself by swinging around black holes in such a way as to make a coherent decipherable signal does not seem likely at all. That's actually in some ways more of a tall order than even a Type 3 Kardashev civilization could easily pull off. But that's assuming the communication is intended for members of its own species. It may not be. There is also the idea of a simple hello signal where alien civilizations send out general signals that may contain no real content, but are unambiguously technological and cannot be produced by nature. This is what Kokoni and Morrison first suggested in the first modern paper on Radio SETI. Not a communication per se, other than the word hello belted out, by a gigantic, powerful, omnidirectional radio beacon for all to see. Such a message simply says, "Hello, here we are. This is technological," without the complication of having to decipher a more complicated message. Perhaps the more complicated message only comes somehow after the aliens get a reply. This led to a paper some years ago by Marek Abramowitz and colleagues, link in the description below, that an advanced Milky Way civilization might have the ability to go to the galactic center's supermassive black hole, Sagittarius A star, and harvest it for energy and use it to send out a hello signal that should be detectable as our gravitational wave detectors become more capable. The idea is this. You take a Jupiter mass object and place it in the innermost stable orbit of Sagittarius A star, which for those wondering is written with an asterisk, and the motion of that would emit an unambiguous signal that could conceivably be observed with ELISA instrument, which is a space-based gravitational wave observatory slated for launch in 2035. That's a ways off, but there is another possibility put forth by Sellers and colleagues, link below, where LIGO may be able to detect an absolutely massive spacecraft. Again, this is Jupiter mass. That would be one astonishing spacecraft to see. But if something of that mass was accelerating to a fraction of the speed of light within a few tens of light years, it might be detectable in gravitational waves while doing so. All options must be on the table since we have no idea what highly advanced alien civilizations do. The closer you get to here, the less mass is needed to see it. So if someone had flung a moon at high speed that passes within 10 light years, it may be possible to see it. There are a number of other future proposed gravitational wave observatories that should, if built, dramatically increase our sensitivity in observing gravitational waves as this relatively new area of astronomy matures. It also offers a whole new avenue for SETI, where one serendipitous signal of artificial origin may be detected from objects being looked at simply for astronomical purposes, like supermassive black holes like Sagittarius A star. SETI scientists can just comb through data already being collected to see if there is anything there. But I leave you with this. If we detect such a signal, and it really was unambiguous, the engineering needed to make something massive enough for detection is off the scale. We'd be seeing someone saying hello, perhaps, that was millions if not billions of years more advanced, and indeed far more powerful than we are. Thankfully, it will be a long time before we can do the same and send a response in gravitational waves. In that regime, we are functionally still invisible. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing dark matter suspiciously because I'm not able to eye it at all. No emissions other than gravity. Being matter, it may have no choice on the gravity, but its staunch unwillingness to interact otherwise with the rest of the matter of the universe does seem rather cliquish and unfriendly, just saying. A club we can never join. Won't even get into the grim view I take of the social skills of dark energy. Expanding the universe. Well, that's certainly not helpful if you're made of normal matter and want to cross space. The deck is stacked against us, folks, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.